Before you listen, I wanted to take a moment to apologize for the sound quality. This is an approximately 2 hour conversation, so it was either reduce the size and sacrifice quality, or increase the size and make it difficult for you guys to listen clearly and smoothly on your favorite podcast platform. So please bear with me. It's not a consistent theme on my show, but I guarantee you that it's still good enough for you to enjoy yourself. That said, enjoy the show. Oh my gosh, I am here at Salamander Cafe with a very, very special guest. You're welcome to the Young God podcast, Mr. Jake Okechukwu Effoduh. Did I say that right?
Perfect. Not many people say my full name, but it's such a pleasure to be with you, Rodney. I have been a follower of your podcast for like a very long time, and you're doing such an amazing, amazing job. Mm. Just before now, I was asking you, like, dude, what media school did you go to? Share some tips and stuff, but you said, this is all you right from within. So kudos. I'm excited to be right here on the podcast. I can't wait to, you know, to speak to you, to learn from you, and to, you know, let's share ideas.
That's why we're here. I mean, that's what, you know, if you follow the Young God podcast, what it's about and what I'm trying to do, you know, you're like the perfect, one of the perfect, you know, guys to be on here. You know, people who are, you know, securing themselves, doing what they got to do and doing it well and just being a force for good wherever you go. And I mean, that's amazing. And not to add that you're a lawyer, you're a partner of Praxis Gnosis.
Yeah,
law firm.
That's good.
Yeah.
You're just getting everything right. Most people don't get my full names right. Not many people pronounce the law firm the way you have. Mm. So you've got it right. Yes, I'm a partner of Praxis Gnosis Law.
Yeah.
It's a law firm here based in Abuja.
Mm.
And I've been a lawyer for over 9 years now.
Mm. So when you hit 10 years, what are we
doing? When I hit 10 years, I will reflect. I would think about, yay, 10.
You know?
At 10 years, I was telling someone yesterday, you can't mess up. You can't F up at 10 years.
Mm.
Your days of having mistakes are done.
Mm.
You have to be right. You have to get everything right. Mm. So no excuses. No, now, wow.
Mm.
You have to make sure that at 10 years, there's no apology, man. If you're given a task as a lawyer, you have to deliver at 100.
Mm. I think at 10 years, it's like you've done your 10,000 hours. You know when they say mastering a skill? Like you've done it now. So you're supposed to be a master almost.
Absolutely.
Sort of. Yeah. I mean, you're also founder of Law2Go Nigeria.
Yes.
Yeah. What's that about?
So Law2Go is an app that I'm developing, and it's the first human rights library online in the entire Africa.
Mm.
I'm not, like, forget about the big name, but that's the dream. I'm trying to make law accessible online. But five things about Law2Go. One, it takes laws and it makes it very simple. So we take laws from complex legalese. I will break it down into common English.
Mm.
This big, big grammar that lawyers speak about the law, we break it down into 1 + 1 = 2.
Mm.
Not only do we break it down into simple language terms, I get to translate these laws into local dialect.
Mm-hmm.
So you can access some of our laws, especially the Constitution, in English, Igbo, Yoruba, Hausa, Pidgin, and French. And then more importantly, the third thing Law2Go does is we convert some of this legal text into audio format. So people who are visually impaired, who can't read, or people who don't really understand, like people who are illiterates, in quotes, who can't read text, can listen to the laws in their language, right? But the idea is to be able to put laws, especially human rights laws, into one place. Now, that's one angle of Law2Go. The other angle of Law2Go, which I'm still developing and still consulting and still building, is to have just like an Uber where you go online and say, how can I access services? For example, I'm a woman who has been abused, or I'm looking to buy a property in Abuja. Where can I find a lawyer? Law2Go. I need law on the go. Where can I access laws? Where can I access legal services on the go?
Yeah.
So that is the big dream of Law2Go. It's still developing, and I'm not a techie I'm a lawyer. I'm a human rights lawyer, and I'm bringing my wealth of human rights law experience into creating this platform. So that's
I imagine a scenario where with that kind of service, you can just holler at at a lawyer, you maybe have a quick question or a quick concern.
Absolutely.
And you just need to get a legal opinion quick and easy without having to set an appointment or start to draft contracts. You just want to know, you know, can I do this? Am I within the legal bounds?
You're plugged in.
Yeah.
When I started law to go, one of the ideas was get legal information on the go. So I asked people on Twitter, what is that one question you want to ask about the law? And people ask questions like, is abortion legal in Nigeria? My husband has been arrested. Can I give testimony on his behalf? And I picked those questions and I answered them and I put them on the website. But that's the exact thing I want law to go to do. Like, oh, I'm being searched by a police officer. I'm a woman. Can a male police officer search my boobs? Like, he's about to. Can I just check? Go on the go and check. And then law to go like, no, you can't. He's not allowed to do that. Only a female officer can do that. You know, just... Can he arrest me? Can the police enter my house without a warrant? You know, these are basic questions people want to know. And it shouldn't be rocket science. These are not questions that you need to pay a lawyer for, get retainership over. Yeah. These are questions that you are entitled to as a Nigerian. And you should be able to find this information on the go for your benefit. And it's, that's the idea. So it's a lot of things in one package, but I'm gradually developing it whilst I'm obviously practicing law on the side.
Yeah. Practicing law. So how do you juggle? I know you're doing a lot of different things, you know, all around the world. So how do you get in that state of mind, you know, to just, you know, do what you gotta do? Because, you know, that's what I feel is the thing with a lot of, you know, young people today. Like, we want to do so much, and then when we start to do it, when we get what we're asking for, it becomes a matter of, you know, adulting is hard, or, you know, who sent me, all those kind of things. Yeah, I mean, we all get that, but so how do you deal? Because you're doing quite a bit.
Adulting is really hard. I think for me, I just say whatever I find my hand to do, I just do it well. But I live with X and O's. You know, as you grow older, you have to X some things and you have to O some things. Like, I zero some things, like, oh, this is important, I have to do it. And I X some things, like, I don't need to do this anymore. You know, as a kid, I wanted to do so much. I wanted to wax an album. I wanted to, you know, model, act in a movie, you know, you know, be an astronaut. Like, you have all these dreams and ambitions. Like, yesterday, I saw some guys who were, like, talking about their dreams. I was like, how old are you, 19, 20? And I'm like, yeah, go for it. But I know by 10 years' time, you would have zoned in on a fewer things. So yeah, I did quite some of those things, you know, anchored radio programs, acted in a movie, even played lead role. But at this juncture now, I'm thinking more critically about what I want to do. And it's still a lot. So I teach, I write, I practice law. These things are connected. They're all sort of within the framework of social justice, human rights, and, you know, leadership. So I try to juggle them as much as I can, but then I don't spread myself too thin. I take my time. I don't want to be a one-minute wonder. I feel like as you grow older, things you want to build institutionals. Like, if you want to make sure what you're building will last for a while and serves a greater purpose bigger than yourself. So that's how I do it. People say, how do you do all of these things and to do them well? I say, time. You know, take your time. As Nigerians, we're trained to just see people's stories in a flash, you know, but take your time. Things that are great, take time. Build yourself, you know, build, relax. I'm not in a rush. Law to Go was started in 2017. It was like, oh, I've had offers. People want to buy the Law to Go. Oh, let's collaborate. I'm like, it's okay. Even if it takes 20 years to, you know, to set up, it's okay. I don't mind someone. Another person will start their own. It's okay. No problem. Let them start, but I would do mine as well.
I'm glad you said that about, you know, taking time, because man, I think that's one of the problems with life today, is that when you want to do something fast or you want things now, you miss the bigger picture of things. I feel like when you slow the game down, slow it down, and just pick your poison and just be content with where you are, that things take time. It changes the game for you.
It changes everything.
But when you want things as soon as, you know, you want them, and then you don't get them, you know, then, you know, you have people start getting depressed or anxious, and you start to compete and compare, and that just messes everything up. So it's a great mindset to have. And I hope, but it's not easy.
I think the journey for me is always the reward. And I learned this very late, that it's not the achievement that matters. It is the ride through. it's not the destination that is most important. It's that journey, going through it. I've met people who have had goals and they achieved that goal and they're still not happy. And they're like, I thought this is what I wanted. But what they did is that they missed the journey. It's like going through university. Mm. The goal is to get a degree. Mm? Mm. If you lock yourself in a room for 4 years and read all the books, you would graduate well. Mm. But you would miss going to university.
Yeah.
That's why they say university has to go through you as you go through it.
Yeah.
It's the experience, mm-hmm. the suffering you went through,
yeah.
the things that were stupid, the things that were fun.
The bond to create.
That's what makes you a graduate, yeah. is that you went to a university mm. and this is the product that you've become. Mm. So the reward is good, but the journey is, you know, is better. The
journey.
I guess.
Not even I guess. Like that's really it. Yeah. The journey is everything. I mean, focusing too much on what the results is kind of takes away from everything. And if you focus on the journey, you're like you're learning as you go. You know, you're really getting wisdom
Absolutely.
From every experience that Absolutely. You're as opposed and the failures as well.
Yeah. And sometimes the journey makes you realize that's not the destination. That where you're going yeah. is not even it.
Yeah.
You know?
Like maybe it's,
we're so into our minds, we think this is what we want. Mm. And then you're like, maybe this is not what I want.
I'll tell you what. Right? I said I was going to tell you about how I did things. And this is perfect because I started as a photographer. And this was in 2013. And I was sure this is what I wanted to do. And the more I think about that phase of my life and everything I went through and, you know, how amazing it was, mm. I just came down to, I was over it. You know what I'm saying? Like, yeah. I could do it in my sleep. I had a style that I was happy with. I had, you know, made a name for myself, but I was now bored. Like, you know, there's something else I want to do.
Yeah.
And, you know, and that's what happens within the journey. I started to learn from you know, my clients.
Mm.
I saw the kind of work I wanted to do more. I wanted to be less an executor and more
mm.
the creator of the ideas that someone else executes. You know, that was the evolution from just being the creator. You get what mm. I'm saying? So that was the next logical step. You know, kind of thing. So yeah. that's what the journey does.
That's what the journey does.
Yeah. yeah. As opposed right. to when you're just so focused on what I want to do and, you know,
That's why I tell people, like, if you plan to do something mm. and the things that you need for it are not ready, mm. start with what is ready.
Mm.
Because if you were not doing the photography, you would not have found
yes,
that, either. Okay, this is what I actually really want. You'd mm. be waiting for things to be perfect to achieve that goal. And then that's it. So the journey is always very, very important.
Right.
If I'm traveling from Abuja to Lagos by road,
mm.
it's not just waiting to when I cross, you know, Ikeja, when I get to Ibadan Bridge or whatever.
Mm.
I'm thinking of Okene. What would I eat at Okene?
Yeah.
When I get to Ajakuta. I love food. The Okene is a landmark. Yeah. I would harness that Okene,
yeah.
squeeze it, enjoy it. I would gist with the Okene woman, eat the food.
Yeah.
I would even stroll around, buy that plantain,
yeah.
you know, check my car, do everything. And then I go. If I get to Bola for, so the journey is part of it.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I think a lot of young people are missing the mark.
Mm.
When they see big celebrities they want to be like, when they see people who they want the, you know,
mm.
that they plan to look like or be like,
mm.
they're so fixated on that outcome that they do not want to venture into the various
processes
mm. that they can enjoy from.
Mm.
And they can realize, I don't really want to be an artist. I just want to, you know, produce artists. I love rap, but I think I just want to write,
mm.
you know? And it happens that way.
Yeah.
You know, when I did a movie, I acted at the lead role.
Mm.
And after that, I got 4 acting offers.
Mm.
2 in South Africa, 1 in the UK, 1 in Nigeria. My dad was pissed. He's like, I didn't train you to become a lawyer for you to be on TV.
Mm-hmm.
He loved me being on TV, but he didn't like the roles I was getting.
Yeah.
And then I was like, oh my God, this is amazing. I want to act.
Mm.
I'm going to be a star. But I didn't really, really want to be in the fall. I just love to be on set.
Yeah.
You know, I just love the life on set.
Mm.
Am I a good actor? I don't think so.
Mm.
But do I love the business of acting?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
So even when I, as a lawyer myself, even when I go to like the US and stuff, I love it when I'm dealing with legal issues between the artists and the publicists, the directors, and you know, I love that because I understand the industry and I've been a part of it. I'm able to provide quality legal advice in that space. That gives me more joy than going for 50 auditions and sleeping on the streets of LA because I want to get a big role.
Oh yeah, that's so well said. Okay, let's go into the God aspect now. That's something that's very dear to my heart.
The young God.
The young God, yes.
You are the young God. You are.
You know, I think we all are. You know, we all are. It's just that I might have maybe put a name to it or put something to it. But in one way or the other, we all are. But since you know what it all stands for from a lot of the posts I put up, how do you live that? How do you relate the idea of, you know, being a God unto yourself?
I find that I'm the one on the driving seat of my car. I am the director of my life. I'm not being directed by something else. I am the one driving that. And so if I turn left, it is me that turned the wheel left. It's not that something turned it, or I might find something here, treasure hunt, blah, blah, blah. No. When I realized that I am responsible for my life, like fully responsible, it changed a lot of things for me. I began to let go of things really easily. You know, I began to compete less. I began to cherish the little things that I could do for myself.
Yeah.
But I also took responsibility for the things that I was able to do or not do. So if things didn't work out, I know that I didn't put enough work. Not that there was a wheel that just didn't.
Yeah.
And if things worked, I recognize, damn, how did it work out? I may have done to sort of checkmate where that came from.
Yeah.
Changed my life phenomenally.
Bruh, tell me about it. Tell me about it. I'll never forget. It started with reading. You know, I read a couple of books. There's a podcast episode that came out, the books that I read step by step that, you know, changed the way I saw the world and myself. And it started with the 48 Laws of Power. Yeah, that's a book that's huge on, you know, self-responsibility.
Yeah.
And what it did was it changed or gave me a new idea of power. You know, when you think of power, you think of lording over someone or, you know, being Thanos or whatever else, you know. You know, but then it just broke it down into a simple idea that the world is the way it is and you are what you are. And if you just navigate in a certain way,
absolutely,
you will be okay. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And that burst my brain. And then I started reading more self-help books in that vein and I was like, you know, and those kind of things kind of change, they like rewire your brain as you go along.
Absolutely.
So you get to a point you're like, when you tell your dad that I'm going to do photography, it's like, what? you get to that point where you can do those kind of things.
Yeah.
And and then when you start to now do more of that, you start to express more of that, your assertiveness, things you want and things you don't want, both in the kind of friends you keep, you know, the places you go, where you want to be seen and not be seen, like even the way you run your social media.
Yeah,
it's not for you, not even for them.
Absolutely.
Like I like when you put something that post, like it takes a certain kind of you know, state of mind to post this and let everybody be damned. You get it? And not many people have that. You know, everyone is still like trying to manage and are so anxious about how they'll be judged. And that is a fucked way to live.
It is. But it's tough. I know I'm 31 now. 26 was my defining moment. 26 was when I said to myself, you know, what do I really want? Like, what do I really want? And that was where I said, just like, damn everything, everyone. I would do what I want. If you like it, hey, if you don't like it. If you compliment me, I would appreciate it, but I would not hold it. The compliment would walk into my left ear and move out of my right ear. Same way, when I trained myself that way, criticisms took the same trajectory. When they came into my head, oh, I don't think, you know, left the other way. And I didn't take things too personal.
Yeah.
My dad was not very rich. In fact, he was not rich. He didn't have. My dad was a clerk all his life. He didn't go to university. And everything I did, no matter how big or small, my dad would always ask me, are you happy? So if I get a good grade, bad grade, if I achieved, I didn't, he was just like, are you happy? And it sounds like a simple question, but it always threw me off. I'm like, okay, so am I really happy? Are you, you know? And at 26, I decided to maximize the things that made me happy. Not only did I become healthier, and I achieved more. I understood myself a lot better. And I was able to transmit that positive energy in my space, in my work, in my academic life, just generally. People are like, it's like, you don't have problems. I'm like, I do have problems, but they don't define, you know, the way I am. I try to maximize the things that make me happy and minimize the things that cause me stress. So it's tough. Before then, I was trying to fit in. I was trying to, like, who exactly am I? Okay, let me do this because everyone is doing it. If I put up a post, people are like, it's not good. I'm like, putting it down. And they say it's good. I'm like, okay, that's the one I'm going to use, you know. But now I don't, like, guy, I don't care, man. Like, this is good for me.
You're above
period. Like, that's it, you know. I have nothing to prove to anyone. I don't have to impress anyone or oppress anyone as well. That's it.
If you feel impressed or oppressed, that's on you, right?
That's on you. That's on you.
Yes. So, yeah, that's it. So, being a God is just being above it all.
Absolutely.
You know, just being above anything, that
being in control. It's just, I'm not such an academic, I read, but it has to be something that interests me. I'm trying to learn to read more. Trying to learn. It's,
read more. Well, read more or read useful stuff.
Absolutely. That's You're right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, okay. I saw this tweet, you know, that you tweeted. Let's dive into socials for a minute. You said,
I'm in trouble because I tweet everything I feel just as I feel it,
right? Yeah, I noticed that you do. And it's funny because as someone who's back in Nigeria, from Toronto and wherever else, you said people are suffering in this Abuja. And you said it like four times, like, people are suffering in this Abuja, people are suffering. So,
because people, you know,
so what did you see? What do you notice that made you compelled you to make that tweet?
Yeah, let me lay proper foundation first before I explain what I meant by the tweet.
Okay.
Abuja is my favorite city to live in the world.
Yeah,
I've traveled to 50 countries. Mm-hmm. Abuja is still my favorite city to be in. Mm-hmm. I love this city.
Mm-hmm.
I've lived most of my life here. Primary school was here. Mm-hmm. University was here. Law school was here. Mm-hmm. Service was here. Like, this is my city.
Yeah.
But to be away for less than a year and come back and see a drastic change, especially a heightened level of human suffering, got me to tweet that. You know, it's one thing to work as an international lawyer and you're reading all the statistics. By 2050, Nigeria and DRC would have 40% of the world's poorest people.
Yeah.
Right? It's like, oh, okay, well. But when you come to the capital of a country and you see this high level of human suffering on the streets, it's only an indicator of what is just a microcosm of the entire country itself. So I was just shocked by the heightened level of human suffering in Abuja.
Yeah.
That made me put that tweet. Like, it was just overwhelming.
Bruh. As someone who's here most of the time.
Yeah. I feel like many people, if I was here all through, I may not have noticed the difference. You know how you don't notice your siblings getting bigger or smaller because you're seeing them every day.
Yeah.
But if you just take a step back for a while, I've not been around for a while, then I got back, the change is just...
Yeah, yeah. There's a saying, nothing lets you know how much... Okay, no. That saying does not apply right now. Mm. Okay. but yeah, I was just going to say that as someone who's here, I can tell you that you're very spot on that. Like, I like to think I'm very observant, and I noticed, you know, over the past 5 years, you know, how things are really deteriorated. Like, it wasn't until recently we started hearing that the police are killing civilians over, I don't know what, you know. And then it's only just led up to, like, so when I heard that the police raped a couple of people, a woman, it was like, you know what? It's not like this, we didn't see this coming. It's not like we didn't know what was gonna happen, because they've been showing that they've been, you know, crossing lines for a while. It was only a matter of time that I was gonna arrive at this.
Yeah.
So then I was like, oh man, so we've gotten here now. So this is what it is now. Now we're gonna start protesting.
Yeah.
Over, like, you get.
Yeah. It's sad because in 2011, I did a survey. I did a research. I spent 2 weeks with a couple of sex workers in Abuja. Like, when I say 2 weeks, like, staying with them day to day.
Yeah.
To record the human rights abuses that they were facing. This was one of the first research I did when I finished from law school.
And I remember writing about it. It got published by an institution in the US, and 86% of the women I had interviewed had faced, I'll just call it rape, but sexual assault in different ways and forms. Mm. And 86% of them, most of them were from like uniformed men or men of unknown groups. So it's been happening. Mm. 86 is about 8 out of 10. Mm. And what makes it sadder is that it's not just a target on women. Mm. It is a target on women, but it's a target on poor and vulnerable women.
Yeah.
So when they say this is about sex work, I say, no, sex work is not just on the streets. Yeah. The ones you see on the street are the poor ones, the ones who don't have, like these are the lowest on the strata of society.
Yeah.
And you judge a society by the way it treats its weakest and most vulnerable. Mm. To be a woman in Nigeria is not even safe.
Mm.
And to be a woman on the streets in Nigeria is
doubly not safe.
And to be a woman and to be a sex worker, like it's just,
Yeah.
But this is not about sex work. It's about how power has been misguided and how, again, the center is not holding anymore. Mm. So people are doing whatever they like with no consequence. And this is what is happening. Mm. So it's just really sad to come back and to see this is the story. Mm. They're packing women in the streets. It is civilizational. I believe that this is a civilizational problem.
Mm.
Nigeria is not just Nigeria, but in our society, we're constantly removing ourselves from the bigger picture of where the world is going. Because countries that were third world countries before, they've moved.
Yeah.
They've moved.
No, yeah.
These kind of stories we hear in some other states, you don't hear them anymore.
Mm.
And let's not compare Nigeria to abroad. This will not happen in Rwanda. It won't happen in Ghana. It won't happen in Tanzania.
Oh, right? Yeah.
It won't. So why would it happen in Nigeria?
So, you know, I always say that, I said once that Nigerian policemen are grossly underpaid. And you get what you pay for.
You know?
I mean, like, not to say that pay is, like, how much you pay to determine the kind of person you are, but...
But it would never... It's beyond pay. I think it's the enculturation of being a police officer. When you're in university, when I went to... So, first of all, police officers, how many of them know the law? They don't go to law school.
Yeah.
They go to police college.
Yeah.
A police officer can do third year law on criminology. That would be good, but they don't.
Mm.
They don't know the law. So how can an institution who have people that don't know the law enforce the law? Isn't that crazy?
Yeah.
So foundationally, that's a problem.
Yeah.
Secondly, it's not a job you aspire to.
Yeah.
It's a job that when nothing holds on for you, then you join the police.
Yeah.
So there's a specific kind of people that joined. I was part of the police force for a while, just a short while before I left.
Oh yeah?
Absolutely. And there's something you become. I don't know how to explain it. There's an enculturation process that after a while, you just don't have that. It's not there. You're just doing what every other person is doing. So the Nigerian problem is not just with the police force, but I keep saying that there are ways that this can be resolved.
Mm.
In Ukraine, they were having the same issues. They closed the entire police and started afresh. And I believe we can do that.
You think we can do that?
Yes. Ukraine did it. They said, we're done. Police, thank you very much. It's been a good time having you around, but we're done. Because when they did that, they realized that, wait, okay, there's nothing happening because they're not there, but they started afresh.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what changed. It's not by training the police officers, giving them more money, changing their uniform, having a new anthem. It's just a complete overhaul of the entire police force. And I think one thing they strategically did was to start by recruiting more women. In fact, the head of the police force in Ukraine is a woman.
Oh.
And so that has changed. I'm not saying the country became better. Things just got way, 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 way better.
So, that's interesting. But, you know, Nigeria is a very, very different kind of state. You know, I don't know if we can survive, you know, if how the order will be maintained if, let's say, for 1 week or 1 month or 2 months.
But what order have we maintained? These people are even the ones causing the disorder. Look, there's.
But it could be worse, though.
As a lawyer, there's certain cases I see, and I'm just like, how? You know, a group of people come out in the afternoon with guns, and you know, they do a thing, and I'm like, and this is like, I understand the value of law and order, and I'm not saying that the police is not doing their job.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just saying that there's a whole lot of problems that a complete overhaul.
I mean, yeah.
I don't know. But then I'm not a police officer.
You know, it's like when you're treating cancer, when you're doing chemo,
yeah,
the idea is that, well, what happens is you totally kill the immune system to allow the drug to,
yeah, you have to do the job. So,
but then it's risky because if the person is just really, 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 really weak, or just
the person can, yeah.
So that's the thing that Nigeria is right now. Like,
yeah,
if you remove the police force, it will allow some.
It's not to completely remove it. It's just a complete overhaul. Like, it needs to come. It needs to start afresh. Mm. They need to recruit more lawyers, more right-thinking people. I feel like
the vetting process should be more stringent.
Not just even the vetting process. I remember somebody tweeted on that said that he joined the police and he was doing recruitment, and when he ran so fast. Mm. He said, "Ah, look at this one. You want to run more than the police? You're not qualified." Like,
oh yeah,
yeah. It's just, I don't know how to explain it. Even when you see someone like a police chief tweeting about, yes, two men are sex workers.
Yeah, I saw that, yeah.
Like, the mind frame of someone who's at the top position in one of the most vital institutions in the country, that just reflects to tell you what is within. You can, those. I joined the police because I wanted to make change. I was like, there's no, we have to go in there. I'm talking to my colleague. We have to listen, we're lawyers. We have to go in there. We have to make that change. We finished from university with excellent grades, law school, excellent grades. What's our limitation? We can speak English. Let's go. One person cannot change the police force. You need a team of people with an ideology and, I don't know how to explain it, a backbone that can withstand that kind of, you will be removed. You know?
Yeah.
You will be removed if you're not speaking the language. So it's just, I recognize the challenge of like police officers.
Yeah.
When you speak to them, they feel that you people are the ones against them, not the other way around.
Yeah.
So it's really, really sad.
Yeah, it's funny how they can also be the victims, right?
They'll tell you that, yeah, and they have their statistics to prove it.
Yeah.
That when people get shot, it's them, you know. There's, in fact, someone is doing a research that showed that, you know, when police officers hold the gun and their hands are on the trigger, the guy has proven that more police have shot themselves by mistake than they've shot other people by mistake. So you see, so I'm like, can we just not have them hold on the trigger? Like yesterday, they were doing the protest and police were holding.
I saw that.
Like, I was like, what's happening in this country?
It's crazy.
It's crazy. Again, as a patriotic Nigerian, I have only one passport, which is green. I always, when I go out, but I always resound the amazing things about being Nigerian, being from Nigeria. So when I come back, it's not just to come and say, yay, it's awesome. It's to think of ways by which these things can change. And I said to myself, when a police chief goes on Twitter abusing people, it's okay for him to apologize. It's okay for him to take down that tweet and be like, guys, I thought it this way, but now from the responses you've given, I kind of think maybe that thing I wrote was a bit sexist.
Yeah.
Now I'm taking it down. People would respect and value you more than just being arrogant and, you know. So those are some of the things that I think we need to, you know, we need to revisit.
Oh, man. Well, I don't know where we're going to start with that because we're so far gone. Like, and you know what? You know what? Anyway. Yeah, let's you know what, on the weekend show, I saw the tweet that you said that we need to turn our conversations into
action. Absolutely.
That was profound.
Especially for young people like our younger ones who did not see an internet age, right? They don't understand how, they think by using a hashtag and then I've contributed to it. But I'm like, yes, you have. You're contributing to the conversation, but then it's not going to make any change. So one of the things I tell people is on Twitter, you have people who are, Twitter is a little bit elitist in terms of the Nigerian parlance.
Yeah.
And people who are tweeting, I don't feel this is okay. I don't feel it's okay. I'm like, if everyone can just turn to their parents, all those rich kids, just turn to your father and say, daddy, as you go to work, say, could you please help me find out what has been done about this case? Could you please help me inquire? That would make a lot more change than coming on Twitter and having that debate. Our older ones are not on Twitter. They're having this debate.
Yeah.
So just changing into action would be really good. A protest is great, but you need to recognize, who am I protesting against? There must be, it's like a football match. You can play, but who are you playing against? When you're protesting, we don't want this. Who are you telling? Are you protesting for public, you know, for publicity? Are you protesting for an action to be made? And you have to be directing your protest to
the power that
the person you're saying, we do not want this anymore. And it's coming from somebody who has done lots of protests anyways. But yeah, this is it. So social media is meant to be the bridge, the oil that would get the act done, not
the end in itself.
Not the end in itself. I recognize the value of social media, but it can be way much more than conversations.
Man, we're in trouble.
We're in trouble, we'll get it right. It's just, okay, let me take that back. I don't know when we'll get it right because Nigeria's GDP is growing at about, let me say, 1%. But our population is growing at about 6%. China's GDP is growing at 6%, population growth at 1%. Nigeria is overpopulated.
Yeah.
There's nothing you can tell me. There's no value in that right now.
Yeah.
There's no country that says, let's grow our population above what we can make economically.
Yeah.
When I see my friends giving birth to children, when I see one and two, when I see a third child, I'm beginning to not say happy congratulations. I'm done. After the third, I'm like, guy, how far? Four children in 2019. You're a Nigerian. How? Like, I don't understand the desire. What is the goal? I don't get it. Well, 201 million, the resources are the same. Have you gone to the IELTS exam? People who are trying to go abroad to go and, like, there's no space.
Yeah.
Which school would they go to? Where would they stay? If you want children so bad, adopt. There's so many. What would you, you've produced one, you've produced two, why three, four, five? And I get it, you might have the money for it, but there's no space, guy. There's no space.
Damn.
I don't understand. Our population is just grow.
You know, even if you have the money, those people that don't have the money, they are still even doing the same.
So when you go to other countries, when I go to conferences, for example, I was in a conference in Norway and they were talking about, it was not really the issue, but the guy said, oh, you know, they're going to build da-da-da-da-da in Norway and then refugees are going to come and do the building.
Mm.
And someone asked, which refugees would do this building with this amount of money? It was quite an engineering, I don't know, it was not really my field, but I was just privileged to be there.
Yeah.
And he said, you know, Africans will come.
Yo.
And I was like, my hands in the air. Excuse me, that's a bit, like, why would you put us into your plan to build your... The guy's like, but you're being used by the Middle Easterns to build. Why wouldn't you want to come to Norway if we just add a little bit of dollars or maybe just health benefits? And I was mute. Because that's the truth.
Yeah.
So Africans and people from other underprivileged countries are taken to this part of the Middle East to just slave.
It's
so if you're producing more people, the world is like, we don't have to produce. We have the, you know, in the before it was they come and take you by force. Now you on your own, you go and come and because your country is not giving you anything, right? Sure. Japan is the Japanese passport is the most privileged passport to have in the world.
Mm.
In Japan, they are. Birth rate is going to a minus, going to a negative. The country is begging them to give birth. The country, they're like, why? What? What's for what? It's not as if they don't want to increase the population, but there must be like
irrational.
So when people say, oh, it's a blessing, like, it's not a blessing. It's not a blessing. When you have one, two, as at the third one, I'm done relating with you. It's not funny.
Yeah. Oh man. So that means at least now we know that you're going to have at least at most two kids. We can confirm that now.
And I feel like you don't have to have your own to have. I have people who I mentor and they're like I don't want to infantilize them, but I will say that they're like my kids because their well-being matters to me. Mm. I like mentor them both on emotional issues, academic issues, And the goal of mentoring is to make sure you produce people who are way better than you.
Mm-hmm.
So none of my mentees will be at my level. Yeah. I made a 2-1 and I mentor you academically to first class.
Yeah.
And that's the pedestal I set. Even though there's no need because I didn't have a mentor and I made a 2-1.
Yeah.
So now you have one, you should make a first.
Yeah.
And my mentees are acing for that.
Mm-hmm.
If I make $50,000, you should be making 150. For that's sure. It. Cause you have a mentor. I'm making it easier for you.
Mm.
I'm introducing you to more clients. I'm telling you where I made mistakes so you don't make them.
Mm-hmm.
So this is what upbringing is. It's raising the next generation to be better, smarter, healthier, and to produce way much more than you did.
Yeah.
So you don't have to have your own.
Yeah.
You can adopt. You can choose not to have any.
Well, man. Okay. I because of time.
Yep.
I want us to dive into something else that is even, and this is close to your heart.
Okay.
Beyonce.
Let's talk about Beyonce.
Beyonce.
Okay.
You're a stan.
I'm a fan. I'm not like the crazy B. Like, I don't have all her gadgets. I've never been to Coachella.
Nah,
I
didn't go to Coachella, but. Don't. Yeah, no. You're a stan.
I miss.
You know how I know you're a stan?
Why? How do you know?
Very simple.
Okay.
When the conversation about MJ and Beyonce came, and you were like, you're even trying to. That's how you know someone who has sipped the honey, the beehive honey. Yeah.
Nice one. Yeah. I know. I was trying to balance the debate. I was like, Beyonce is the king now. MJ was the king then. MJ is dead. So let's focus on who's alive. But people are like, no, Jake, don't bring that. You cannot compare Beyonce to Michael Jackson. And I'm like, first of all, people can be compared to anything. Mm-hmm. That's, you can compare anyone. I respect Michael Jackson. May he so rest in peace. He's a legend. He's unbeatable. Mm-hmm. So is Beyonce. Just that.
But there's levels. That's all we're saying.
I mean, it's like comparing. Sometimes you just can't. Like, how do you compare?
Obama is a legend. You can't compare him to Mandela. You can.
But like, you can't. Like, both of them are.
But they're not equal. That's what we're saying.
But there's no need for them to be equal. There's no need for one to be better than the other. They're both phenomenal. Period.
No.
Let's not have this argument because if we have to go, I'll go with the one who's alive. but going there, I believe that. I like what you said now. You can't compare Obama to Mandela. Like, both of them are just in their, you cannot buy Obama's book and be like, I don't want to read Mandela. Like,
But that's not the point. We're not saying that we're picking one or the other. We're not saying that, oh, Michael Jackson, go Beyonce down, or we're not going to watch Beyonce's homecoming. And we're saying that, you know, like, when you're trying to, you know, compare impact, compare achievements, compare, you know, what they had to deal with in their times.
Yeah.
And what they did, what they had.
Yeah. I mean,
that's what I'm saying.
For me, I didn't want to go into the comparison debate, but I believe both of them have equally achieved at a really, really high level. And I feel like comparing them is already injustice to both of them. Because you end up making people hate one. Like, how dare this person? Because it's not them comparing themselves. Mm-hmm. Beyonce is a product of Michael Jackson.
Yep.
Michael Jackson inspired the likes of Usher, Beyonce, Chris Brown. Mm-hmm. Name it. Who did Michael Jackson not inspire? Mm-hmm. In primary school event, everybody wants to break. Mm-hmm. Like, Michael Jackson he's more than just, like, he's an entity.
Yeah.
Right? Comparing that to Beyonce, the goal was to recognize that Beyonce is
great.
Is like, she's so great that her light is shining. So was Michael Jackson's life.
Yeah.
But even if you ask her, she'll say, why now? Why would you compare me to Michael Jackson?
Yeah.
But the point I was trying to make is, don't now use this as an opportunity to undermine Beyonce, because someone started comparing Beyonce to, what's that girl's name?
Beyonce something.
What's her name, Seth? This Chema Jesus. I was like, come on. You compare Beyonce. They were like for Beyonce, reason for Chema Jesus. And Chema Jesus got more votes. I was like, how can Chema Jesus be better than Beyonce? But this is the product. People are just going to hate Beyonce. See, you need to, Beyonce is somebody who I've really studied. And when I watched Homecoming, what gave me joy was to see that she had worked with about 4 or 5 Nigerians.
Okay.
Even gave one a platform to introduce herself on the platform. My name is this, I'm from Nigeria. Da, 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 da. Beyonce had picked a dancer from Nigeria. The guy came all the way from Benue State. He's from Utuku or something. Like, Beyonce samples Fela's music.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
She had mimicked Fela's work.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody is an artist who learns.
Mm-hmm.
How many Nigerian artists go to Bangladesh to go and pick up a sound? Mm-hmm. Or goes to, you know, rural Lesotho?
Mm-hmm.
But an artist is a product of excellence. Mm-hmm. She works hard.
Mm-hmm.
A whole Beyonce will record 60 songs and produce 10.
Mm.
Ordinarily, you want to do 5 and want to release the whole 5. Do you get what I'm saying? Like, a lot of work goes into her stuff.
Yeah.
And I think for a black woman,
you know what I wish? You know what I wish? I think, you know, Beyonce is such an example, Serena, such an example to women that I wish that more women focus less on the glam of it all.
Yeah.
And more like, you know what these guys did to get there?
On the work.
If you have these girls look at that and try to, you know, copy that, whoa.
You're right.
The game is changing.
You're absolutely. Beyonce doesn't look at her phone.
Mm-hmm.
She doesn't look at time. She doesn't look at time. Like, there's no, she doesn't look at, when you're working with Beyonce, one of the rules is you don't say it's 3:30 now, 4 o'clock now. Mm-hmm. Her team does not report to her like, these people said this about you online. No, they don't. Mm. So these people have, Serena Williams, there's a documentary being Serena. Mm. When you watch what it takes for Serena to, you know, I don't know how people feel like you can just liken yourself to the glam of these people without recognizing the work that they put in.
Mm.
It is crazy. For Beyonce to stand in Coachella, she had to see the amount of weight she had to lose. She had a complication giving birth to her twins. She went into CS.
Mm-hmm.
At a point, she was eating only one avocado a day. Like, working out, it's not easy. You know, it's not easy. Yeah.
It's not easy.
So, you're right. The work is, so when people say, oh, Serena Williams wore this, I'm like, who cares what she wore?
Who cares? You know, who cares? Okay, you know what else? When they talk about Serena Williams, they talk about the fact that she had a baby and then she went right back to playing.
Yeah.
You know, they glamorize that as if,
yeah.
You know, but I'm trying to tell them, like, yo, that's her job. That's her work. If she wins, she gets paid.
Absolutely.
You get, and so it's not like she did it because she has to prove anything. She's doing it because this is what she does well.
36 Grand Slam. People are saying things like, it's not enough. I'm like, when you know your lifeblood, as a photographer, you can't be like, I've taken a picture of this one that won the, what they call that prize they normally win. So I'm sitting down. No, you take more. You keep going for it. If you can do it, do it.
Do it.
You know, it gets very lonely as you climb up. Mm. The competition is less as you climb up.
Yeah.
So why not go for it? Especially when it comes to music, you would never be on top forever.
Yeah.
Same thing with sports. You'll never be as strong forever.
Yeah.
So when you are in the forefront of it, in the game of it, you kill it.
You kill it.
When I was in New York to work with a record label, with other lawyers who were doing work for them, I was amazed to learn that some of the artists wake up at 5 o'clock. It was from there I learned that Nicki Minaj does like how many sit-ups in the day. You know what I'm saying? Like 150 a day or something like that.
Yeah.
They wake up in the morning, they go to the gym, they comply to read the news. At least Washington Post, New York Times, you know, complied. Not like they just, then there's certain things they can, there's the time, like it's work, you know?
Mm.
Then they produce tons of songs and they must get qualified every month. So you produce maybe 6 songs with your team. You must have one that the record label will be like, okay, this we can work with, right? If you don't get one, if you're not producing songs very often and they don't like, okay, then you'll be out of, like, they work hard.
Mm-hmm.
So an artist wake up at 10, I'm like, they want to blow and be, you know, like, praying to God, you want to be like, how? They work hard.
Yo.
It's tough.
No.
So, you know, if you're going to be a rap artist, you have to be producing constantly, Yeah, so it really blew my mind, you know, when they signed up a particular artist. She's phenomenal. She's good. She's really big now in the US.
Mm-hmm.
But when she came on board, they had a conversation with her. They said, you're just 10% of you.
Mm-hmm.
The person who would write, the person who would handle your social media,
mm-hmm.
the publicist who would take you out,
mm-hmm.
the producers who would work on your songs and edit it, the editors, the,
mm-hmm.
like your nutrition. See, guy, you're only 10. You're bringing 10. We're bringing 90.
Yeah.
So you do your bloody part, we will do ours. And they know that they are only 10. When you become such a big figure that you become a 60-70%, then you can do, but you are 10%. So when we say 6 o'clock, you're coming here, you know, you're packing your hair at the back, you're sitting down, you're doing this work. I don't know if many artists have that work ethic. For example, when I see YJ in Nigeria, I see phenomenal talent. Management zero. What he needs, huge investment and a phenomenal management team.
Mm.
She would be A-list in a year or two.
Yeah.
You know, you can't be an artist and you are the one handling your social media, you're the one going for shows, you're the one asking Cadbury for, you know, end of year party. You cannot be the same. Yeah. You would break.
Yeah.
It's impossible.
You can't do it all.
You can't.
Yeah, you know, so yeah, that's like, so in the end, it just goes down to work ethic. People always think that, you know, there's always that instance of luck that happens, but you have to bring in the work half the time for that to happen. And, you know, when you hear people say, I cannot come and kill myself. Like, see that, just saying that out loud is really sending the universe.
You're right.
You really disqualified yourself from anything.
You're right.
You know, when you're looking for a job that will just be a ride for you. You, you get paid, you just do the minimum. Then you're already putting yourself.
Then you're going to do what the minimum is going to do.
Yeah.
You know, if it's so easy for you, it will be easy for every other
everyone
person,
else. Right? And you will not have, you know, your potential stretched.
Absolutely.
I remember I was having a conversation with Asha Sambo on this podcast, and she comes from a privileged family, and she was telling me how she would say to herself, where is my struggle? Do you get, because she read all these books, and she knew that what it takes to be great required challenges and facing your fears head on.
Yeah.
And she had it all, you know, and then her father died. Now struggle came.
Yeah.
And she
had to.
She built. Do you get what I'm saying? And I see that, I'm like, you know, if more girls had that kind of
thinking,
you know, so forget like all this women empowerment. Like, it starts from you. Like, all these women cannot go and do it for you.
You have to do it
yourself. Jay Mohammed.
Yeah.
She's there. She's just an ideal, an example, but she cannot do it for you.
Absolutely.
You get Beyonce cannot do it for
absolutely.
You.
Absolutely. You know? That's why I said, I mean, I have two types of clients. Who, when they talk to people who are very wealthy and privileged and have a lot of money, I have two types of clients I've noticed. I have a couple of clients that they make their children feel comfortable. They give them all the luxury life and everything. And that's that. But I have another set. I know that what they do is they prepare their children for when they will not be, when I will not be there. You're preparing them for the future such that when you leave, it's like, I know they will be fine.
Fine,
you know, it's not making sure their life is enjoyable and sweet
at the moment.
It's about preparing them for what is coming up. So I'll give it, I'll give an example.
Sure.
If you take a flight and find kids on business class or first class, you see them like either just like literally watching, playing game or just enjoying. The fitness is normal. Yeah. I mean, it's been, I'm supposed to fly a business class. Like, what else would I fly before? But you have the ones who know exactly what it took them to get there.
Yeah.
And they would read, you know. With privilege, you give, make sure you give, get them the best of schools, give them the best of tools. You know what I'm saying? Give them resources that they would not, that money would not, that they know that money can buy, and that's it. Not just to be enjoying life.
Yeah.
They will enjoy, they can find that enjoyment, but fulfillment, they will not get it from enjoyment.
Yeah. Oh yeah, never.
Yeah.
Man.
So,
guys, you know what? I think life is very simple. When you figure out exactly what you're supposed to do and how you're supposed to do it.
Yep.
You know, you can, I think, and when you said life in Abuja is suffering, when you said that, I was like, that is true. But for me, like, I know people who are even more well off than me, myself, who are, you know, feeling it mentally in terms of, you know, you know, but I think I'm pretty okay mentally. Yeah. I know, you know, I know what's up. I know what I'm trying to do, and I know how I'm going to do it. And like, it makes the suffering easier for me to manage, you know, but for what are people who don't have that mindset, you know, they expect instant gratification, you know, they expect, you know, and you know, it's school that fucked us up. You know what happens? I was thinking about it. You know, we're taught that everything in life will be solved with good grades. We're taught that from, you know, they said, get good grades, life will be good. Go to uni, get good grades, read, study hard, work hard, life will be good. Even your parents be like, get good grades and, you know, you enjoy life.
Yeah.
But what they didn't tell you was that there was the mental aspect.
Yeah.
They didn't tell you that there are things that if money can't buy, good grades can't even buy.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
That's true.
And then we're hit with all the surprise of life itself. And now adulting is hard.
You're right. Absolutely right. I think what our parents didn't imagine that we would have mental problems. They were like, that is already sorted. You know, parents are good. Our parents' generation didn't really have, maybe they had mental issues, but then they were like, it was more economical.
Yeah.
They just needed to get the best for their kids. And I, for example, my dad never went to university. I don't even know if he went to secondary school, but he made sure that at least got an education. And I know the value of that. I know the value of that. So I respect that a lot. Suffering is, the highest level of suffering is quite mental. Because if a person doesn't feel okay about themselves, there's nothing you can do. If the whole world is like, you're the best, I'm talking about Michael Jackson, if it's in their mind, they just, that frame of mind needs to be, so when you're training a child, you need to be ensured that they have the right, they forget about how they look, it's about what they're thinking and how they think of themselves. That's what the mind does to you. You have to be content. I've learned to be content. I mean, a keke na pep, guy, this is where I can be, and this is what I can afford. I'm okay, guy. You know, I tell my friends that I would rather pay not to hang around people with bad energy than to be there even if they're serving champagne, right? I just, you have to be content, and less competition makes you more content. Like, you need to be know your battles. Don't compare yourself too much. No priorities, because just stick to what you can and do it. In life, there are many things that I cannot do, but instead of trying to do and learn them, just pick the ones you can do and keep doing them well. Done. Right? So I've met people who have money, but they just don't have that, which is why I make it a point of visit to my friends to remind them, like, you're amazing. My God, you're good looking. Even my friends who are married, I'm like, girl, what's up? You're beautiful. And it's amazing how their husbands don't tell them. I don't know. I'm not trying to be in their husband's position, but just to remind, these are my friends. Yeah. Like, you know, do you know you're really smart? Like, my friend wrote several books, and yesterday he gave me 2 copies, and I told him, you're actually prolific. He's like, really? I'm like, you've written over 40 books. You shouldn't be telling me, really. You should know.
Yeah.
But people need to know. You know, people need to know. They need to understand that this is, and sometimes you need to tell yourself, look, know what you are, know where you are, and you just, like, stick with it. Because the biggest suffering people face is in their minds.
Oh, yeah.
It's in their minds. And it screws people over a lot. I teach, and I find that when I try to judge my kids by their academic performances, but that has changed. My first year of teaching, I was doing that a lot. Oh, this is the smart one. This is the Lodo. But now I've changed. I feel like people are a combination of different things. You know, their past, their gender, their nationality, their sexuality, their economic status combined to make them who they are. And everyone is different and distinct. And you must respect and follow each one on their trajectory that way.
Yeah. That's the way.
Yeah.
Bro.
That's it.
That's the way. And and when you do that, you find that you become a deeper person yourself for doing that. And then now you're positively touching these people's lives.
Absolutely.
You're getting to the core of their essence, not just, bro, this interpersonal relationship thing. There's levels to it, man.
Yeah.
And I this is one of the things I want to hack, because especially in my line of work, when you're building brands, you know, your job is basically to get in the mind of who the people are supposed to be enjoying this thing and trying to get to the heart of their needs and wants and satisfy it. So, I'm so glad you said that. And if more people knew that, you know, we'll be somewhere else. So I'm back with Mr. Jake Effoduh. We've been having such a great time on the podcast. The conversations have been mind blowing. I don't know about him, but I personally,
I have been the one learning from you, the young god. You know, we are. It's such a privilege
to be able to speak with you.
For real, really, really, such an honor.
Thank you. I mean, now we're gonna play a game.
Okay.
Yes, we're gonna play a game that I stole from Larry King. Who was on my podcast, actually.
Okay. Oh, yeah. Oh.
Yeah. Yeah. So, quick fire questions. I know you have a lot of wit.
Okay.
And humor. So we're going to test them today on the show. What's your secret talent?
Am I supposed to answer fast or think about it?
You can think about it.
Okay. My secret talent?
Yeah.
I'm very good at design. Space design.
Oh, space design.
Yeah, like I can manage spaces. And yeah, you only know this if you've come to my space.
Yeah.
There's a lot of things, but you don't see anything.
Oh.
Yeah, you walk into my room, everything looks just clear, but I have everything available. You just need to know.
That is some Zen shit, man.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah.
I know. Oh, trust me, you don't want to know.
Okay.
Yeah, but that's it.
Space design. So you can design... You can design.
I don't think I can do it for I can't do it economically.
Okay, just for yourself.
If I take a room and I know what the person needs and wants, I can design it such a way that it's super efficient for them.
Okay, that kind of makes sense. That makes sense. Okay. What's the worst piece of advice you've ever gotten?
The worst piece of advice I've ever gotten. Something about see what your mates are doing, or something like that. I think it was something my elder ones used to say, like, see what your mates are doing. I can't really, it's not an advice, but it's just more likely comparing me to my mate. And this foolish idea that because I was in the same class with certain people, then automatically our lives must go in the same trajectory or direction.
Yeah.
These people are different ages, and even if they're the same age, but from different backgrounds, they have different needs. The fact that I served with someone and they're now doing this and I'm not doing that, that's a stupid advice to just be in the same tandem with your mate. whether you're doing better than them or worse off, that's just ridiculous. So I don't want to, this idea of my mates, you know, this, we're at the same level. No, I can't remember what the advice was, but I knew how I always felt when people compared me with my mates.
Yeah.
Even when they say, oh, you're doing better than your mates. Just like, I don't
understand. You don't even know. You don't even know, you know? Yeah. And you know, I get that a lot because, well, you know Sam Laboji?
Yes.
Yes. He went to Loyola as well. We're in the same class. In fact, it was him than me. Okay. We were troublesome kids. We got into a fight one time where he threw, you know, combination lock.
Yeah.
He threw it at me, man. I mean, it was crazy back in the day. And now, you know, Andela.
Yeah.
You get what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
So, and now, obviously, people will expect among us Loyola guys that, we should feel some type of way that, he has done that and we haven't done anything similar. I'm like, do you get, like, so that mentality is always there.
Yeah.
But like I said, we're above it. I mean, some of us are. I don't know about other people.
Yeah.
You know, congrats to him.
Congrats to him. But beyond the things we've achieved and the titles that we have fixed to our name, I think the ultimate question is who we are as individuals.
Oh, yeah.
So if we strip all ourselves naked and we appear in some country in China with no money and everything, who are you?
Who are you?
You know, who are you as a person without the titles? So if you ask someone to introduce themselves and they go, I am, that has to do with titles, positions, CV, that's good, really good, but then ultimately, like, who are you as a, like, what, who are you? Knowing who you are is a challenging task because you have to keep defining yourself as things go on.
Yeah, and there's a saying that goes, if I am what I have and what I have is lost, then who am I?
Mm.
You get that kind of thing?
Yeah.
So, I read that early on. So I started getting that idea of like, okay, you know what? These things are just things, you know. What are you when everything is gone? You know, so that's a very important question that a lot of people can't answer. And because of that, they try to fill up the voids with, you know, all, you know, having all the many friends.
Absolutely.
Okay, so who would you like to be stuck on a desert island with?
Stuck on a desert island with?
Feel free to shout out any of your friends or even a celebrity. Go ahead.
One person or several people?
I'll let you express that.
So, stuck in an island, I would definitely need a chef, someone who's funny, so that I would not just die of boredom, and then somebody who's really creative or hardworking. So maybe a chef, maybe Chef Emeka, because he seems to like food. So he will produce, maybe he'll turn the sand into cake. You know, somebody who's funny. I like VD. I don't know if you know VD.
I don't know.
He's in Abuja here. Okay. Well, I mean, he's funny. When I read his tweets, he thinks like me. Like when I read his, I'm just like, oh my god, this guy is so fucking crazy. Who thinks like this? So I feel like with our whole heat, he'll be able to create something. And then somebody who can bring out stuff from anything. Let me see who's even a hustler. I don't know. Deji Bamibola, he's my colleague.
I know Deji, your partner.
Yeah, my partner. Yes, Deji is very hardworking. He'll be able to. Whatever it is, Deji can dig the ground for water. Emeka can make the food so I can eat, and then the video will obviously make us laugh and, you know, carry us through. So stuck in a desert, I want to be stuck with these kinds of people that are able to create stuff and will make me maybe not either stay alive, but at least elongate the time span before I burn to death.
That's a good answer, actually. Your strangest fan encounter.
My strangest fan encounter. I've had so many strange ones.
I know you have.
I have. Once I was in Lagos for a wedding. I didn't know I needed an invitation. It was a big wedding. And then I got to the event. In fact, the guy before me, him and the bouncer fought or something like, because he didn't have a, you know. So when I got there, the guy was just like, he carried me and, you know, he literally took me to the high table and I was like, you know, what's happening?
The bouncer.
The bouncer, obviously, he had seen me, he knew me, he had followed me for a while. Wow. The guy was just like, are you kidding? You know, that was quite touching. But I've had several ones that were,
I could talk about
humbling. Yeah, like I was in I was in Maiduguri in the market, and a woman there who sells like some stuff was able to recognize my voice and realize I was the one doing the program, the radio program on radio. And she called the other women, and like I've had encounters. Yeah.
Oh damn.
Yeah, so I've had like so many encounters, not the very flashy ones.
Yeah, but just
A taxi driver one time in Abuja. I'd lost all my stuff and he picked me in the taxi. And when he heard my voice, he recognized I was the guy on radio. And not only did he drove me around till I found my stuff. Like, I've had all kinds of fun encounters.
Bro, you see, I think this is the power of voice, man. I mean, for now, we focused on pictures, videos, all these things. But that's why podcasting is growing right now, you know, because the power of the voice is becoming a thing. Like, when you can relate to a voice, your voice that... And nothing is more unique than voice, bro.
Yeah, you're right. You're right.
You can recreate many things, but a voice.
It's also what the voice... Also what the voice does. Like, as a child, I grew up with a speech defect. I used to stutter. It was terrible. I was a stammer as a kid. And as a kid, it wasn't like I would stammer a bit. Like, it was heavy. It
wasn't the sexy stammer.
You know, so I didn't... Speaking was not really my forte.
Yeah.
I had to learn to know what words to use or not use. Yeah. And I never went... Like, I mean, doing radio came by chance. But when I did radio, I wasn't doing talking important stuff. I wasn't talking unimportant stuff. I was talking about life and death kind of issues.
Yeah.
I was traveling to local villages. I was interviewing people who would never, ever, you would never hear on radio. So my life was going to very remote places, profiling the lives of people whose lives would not be readily profiled on radio.
Yeah.
So I never expected any celebrity-dom to come from that, popularity to come from that. But I knew how humbling it was to go to a market in Efo in the Delta State, and the woman selling meat would scream and call all the others, and they'll mimic you and try to mimic your laugh or say something you said, or you walk into a school and then, you know, everyone's following you around because they listen to your program. Just the embarrassment of walking on a campus, Delta State University, and students are just following you as you're walking away because of a radio program that you're doing. I think it's humbling. You know, I would just sit down quiet and just wonder, what the hell is this? But it was humbling. It humbled me a lot when I learned so much about people and their experiences for over 11 years. I just cannot make my life more important than theirs. I'm just one person in the world of 7 billion. I'm just as unimportant as just as I'm important. And I'm able to understand difference, uniqueness, just individuality. And that's just the most phenomenal experience. So my biggest fanship moments have not been like, there's been so many stories I could share, including one in a hospital, just like all kinds of stories that motivated me to be who I am today.
So, to go further,
yeah. It's not from Instagram, no. It's
from radio. I know. From radio, I mean, I'm trying to put myself in your shoes as you're telling those stories of things that happened. Like, oh, wow, that would humble anyone. You know?
It did. I have a friend who was, I mean, at that time, I would say he had AIDS. Let me just put it that way. He used to listen to my program. We were in the same university. But then when we met, I met him in a hospital. This was like when HIV and AIDS was like a big deal. They were on TV. They would show the skull and the bones, like death and the danger. You know what I'm saying? So he was in Guagalada Hospital at the time.
They
put him in a different part of the hospital. His ribs were showing. Like, his skin, his eyes were yellow. He was gone. And I came and I could see the excitement that I came to see him. This guy he's been listening to on radio. And anyway, the long and short was he got better, you know?
Yeah.
And when he left the hospital, he came straight to my house. And he said, I was listening to your program while I was there and just hearing other people who were just like me to see how much they've lived. That was the only inspiration I need. I don't think it was the drugs that made me well. It was the program that made me well. Again, it's not my program. I was just a presenter, so I can't take glory for it. But I remember how close we became. He said I must MC his wedding, which I did. I must be there for every his students when they give birth. You know, like just being a part of his life and connecting with him from radio was just phenomenal.
Bro.
So I even had him on the show. Or brought him on the show. Like we vibed. We now went to the same university on his graduation. I was like, we became really close. And so when I see him today giving speeches abroad, and I see him and his beautiful family on Instagram, I just can't help but feel grateful for the privilege to have been a part of that show.
Dude. You know, unless you say like, what is he saying? When he says like he was really inspired by the show, I'm like, maybe he's just saying it. But you know, again, it's not me. I was just a little part of the of that process. And whilst you think I inspired him, he did inspire me. Because when I see someone whose life was at the like the this edge. Is it. This is the like, and then I see him bounce back from that.
You have no excuse.
I'm just like, what?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. And I keep saying that, right? Like, to people, I was at this event and some other guy was talking about how, you know, some people have a leg up in life and, you know, that's how they become successful. That whatever it was that, you know, don't have the same privileges or the same, you know, circumstances that make people succeed. I'm like, yo, man, you know, what I know about life is that the greatest equalizer is the mind. That is
profound. The greatest equalizer is the mind.
Because I've seen people who had everything lose it all.
Mm.
People who had nothing make it all.
Mm.
People who had,
you're right,
50 cents was at the cusp of death.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Look at what he's doing now.
Yeah.
Some other guy has been living forever and they can't do nothing. Like, so when you look at these things, you're like, either you know something or you're just good at staying alive and staying on the ball.
Absolutely.
But once you give up, once you say you're just going to be a victim.
Yeah.
It's over.
You're right. Because you're absolutely right. I find like there are a lot of people who are already dead. Mm. Let's just be real. They're just existing around. Mm. You know, their mind is at a zero. Yeah. So they might be existing, but they're really not existing.
Yeah.
So sometimes, like you said, 50 Cent, when that term get rich or die trying, so like, but if you sort of think of where he was when he was like, man, get like die trying, like, you know, when you consider dying trying as an option, like, I don't mind dying trying, put it there.
Yeah. You know, his mindset was,
you know, so I cannot go and kill myself. It's one person.
Yeah.
Get rich or die trying is another person. And they might be in the same community facing the same challenges, but their mind, like you said, is where there's disequilibrum.
Yeah.
That is profound.
I read somewhere else that, that's profound. Like, when you think of it like that, you're like, man, you have no other option but to just do. When you said that guy was about to die on the edge of death and now he's, you know, you're like, what excuse do you have but not to just do it?
Exactly.
You know, another book I was reading said, what separates people of achievement is not people who do stuff and those who don't is not skill. It's just how your mind is set up. Like, they will have the same skill, amount of talent,
you're right,
you know, but what makes you up in your head is what takes you further.
You're right.
You know,
you're absolutely right.
You look at Ronaldo, you look at charisma.
You're absolutely You're absolutely right. That's, you know, and it's so great that the thing that equalizes us is not commodified. That is just, you know,
it's the one thing they can't take from you.
The most valuable things, like air, there's not that quality of air, you know, like, there's no Gucci air or Prada air, you know, there's no Gucci mind, but like, we are the ones that make us who we are.
We are.
That is so profound.
The reason is people have come from the lowest of the low to become everything.
Hmm. The mind is the greatest equalizer.
Yeah.
I'm writing that down right now.
Quote me. Someone said death is the ultimate equalizer. I'm saying the mind.
The mind. Yes. The
ultimate equalizer.
Absolutely.
Oh, no.
Absolutely.
You see Trump, he had, you know, the odds were not in his favor in the beginning. And if anything, that's what I take from that. Forget his policies, forget who he is as a person. Like, we can argue that later.
Yeah.
But he did something that most people in the situation would not have been able to do.
You're right.
In a world where, you know, it's people are increasingly judgmental and polarized on different issues.
Yeah.
He was able to burn through the noise, which is own noise.
Absolutely. That's the thing about being crazy. They cannot, anybody who tries to do what Trump was doing now, they say, Trump has done it.
Mm.
Which is why when people have crazy ideas in their mind, I'm more about like the crazier, the more unheard of, the more, I don't even think this can work. The more the chances of it being groundbreaking is there.
So I
don't regret many things in my life because I know that as a young person I did almost everything that my, you know,
energy,
I did everything. The ones I didn't do, I regret them, but I feel bad for people who didn't even do anything at all. I'm just like, now that we're adults, how do you feel? So people are carrying a lot of regret in their mind. People are carrying a lot of
it's better to do it and fail woefully than not even to do it at all.
Because now that thing about what if, that what if always haunts you. But if you did it, at least now you know that you can move on.
And the response should be, and so fuck what?
Yeah, and so fuck what?
Yeah, you know? So what? So, yeah.
Yeah, oh man. I've met people like that who carry this dark cloud of regret on them for nothing. Like, if you meet someone like that, you see it. They're just, you feel sorry for them. Yeah. Like, you know, you wish, and you, time is gone.
You can, yeah, there's nothing you can do. There's nothing. It's gone. So people need, see, a lot of our mates have like a kind of mental burden, mental stress with them. And it's sad that with the education we got, we're not prepared to deal with mental issues.
Yeah.
But a lot of people have mental issues. And I feel like having a conversation like on the podcast, for example, giving them a platform to speak and just share whatever it is in your mind would help a long way.
Yeah.
People don't really speak or talk about those things that are, it might be trivial, it might be stupid, but it's important to talk about it.
Yeah, you know, I think it's good the conversation is coming out now, because earlier, when you're going through those things, you think you're the only one going through it.
Yeah.
So you don't want to talk about it. You don't want to be the weird person.
The weird person, yeah.
But now that everyone, we can all share in that, you know, struggle. I think now is the best time to speak it out. And man, I mean, now you see people coming out challenging their parents.
Yeah.
Because now they want their power back.
Absolutely.
It's a beautiful thing. So what are the perks of being a popular guy?
The perks, I get free clothes. For example, the outfit I'm wearing now is free, made by Suburban Tailors. All I need to do is, when I wear the outfit, I need to just tag them on Instagram.
Yeah.
But it's funny, I don't have that many Instagram followers. I have friends who have like 100K, 500K, 1 million. So I wonder what they get. They do get money. I get free lunch, free outfits.
Yeah.
But my popularity is not really, like I said, on Instagram or anything. I think my popularity came from my radio program that I did.
Yeah.
Because the program was reaching over 24 million people every week. So it would be hard for me to walk into any state today and not be able to recognize a couple of people or them not be able to recognize me. That's, I'm not that popular, but I find those are quite good perks.
Well, I'm not even talking like Instagram popularity. I'm just, like just in general, like, you know,
There's the good and the bad.
Yeah.
For example, I mean, I get free clothes and, you know, as being popular, people kind of recognize it, but I'm very bad with faces and names. So people can see me sometime and they're looking at me and I'm looking at them and they think I know them, but I'm not, I'm not obliging, whatever. Also sometimes, like I'm an introvert. It doesn't look like I'm an introvert, but I am an introvert. I spend most of my time alone. But then people can say, okay, maybe you're snobbish or you're weird. Like when I'm out of the house, I'm out of the house. My mind and soul is prepared for it. I'm energy 100%.
Yeah.
When I'm indoors, I'm indoors. So people just have high expectations for popular people.
Yeah.
Like, people just expect me to be successful, making money. Like, I can't take cab, I can't enter cafe. Like, that expectation is there. I think people sort of conflate popularity with wealth. Like, when you're popular, you can't be poor or go through issues or challenges.
Yeah.
Which is funny. But yeah.
Okay, what do you wish you were good at?
Singing. I wish I could sing. At some point, not now. I mean, everything I wished I was good at, I made sure I got good at. But something I kept saying, if I could. Oh my God. What am I stressing myself for like this? I would be, you know, because I sort of understand the business of music and creativity and art. I was a really creative kid, I just didn't get the platform for it. I used to paint, I used to write stories, I used to dance professionally, and I made a lot of money from dancing. Before I studied law, I was thinking I was going to be a professional dancer. So I was good, I was a creative person. But yeah, what else do I think I wish I was good at? I wish I was good at pretending. I don't know how to pretend. I don't know. Like, if I'm not okay with something, it's obvious. If I don't like somebody, it's obvious. Like, I don't know how to manage vibe.
Yeah, that would be a good skill to have.
I wish I could. My friends can. They see somebody that they know if we're not clearly in good, they'll just be like, hey. Man, I'm just mute. I'm just like, this person doesn't exist.
Period.
I don't know how to do. I can't stand. Yeah. I cannot. You know, if I have a boss that I can't stand, I would quit. I don't know how to explain. But I think it's extreme. When I'm working with a person that I love, it's 110%. Like, I'm giving my all. I can die on it, you know?
Yeah.
But then if I'm not vibe, I can't. I would pay not to even be there.
That's
so I wish I could. Sometimes it's not good enough because you need to be political in today's world. You need to be able to accommodate all those. I don't know how to. So I wish I was good at that.
You should learn that.
I should.
Yeah, especially in today's world. I mean, I've been in situations where pretending, has got me, like, good.
Yeah.
Results, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like just being able to have that poker face.
Yeah.
Or, you know, just disguise my true feelings for a moment. Doesn't mean I'm not lying to myself. I'm just lying to you.
Yeah.
You get what I'm saying? But yeah. I mean, and I don't think there's anything bad with that. You just have to get what you need to get.
Yeah.
In that moment. So, yeah.
I need to learn that. I wish I was good at that.
Yeah. You should. Read. Any of Robert Greene's book, you know Robert Greene?
Yeah, I know Robert Greene.
He speaks, all his books touch on that topic of just being able to adapt, both, you know, emotionally and physically to the situation, so you can, you know, reach your goals.
I think I need to learn that. I remember 40 Laws of Power was like trending for a long time. I know people criticize it for being very manipulative. And that it works for like the centuries when you had like military kind of thinking. But I feel that sometimes in Nigeria, like you need to have some of those within your.
Imagine doing NYC without being able to pretend. Imagine, yes, imagine going through all these governmental organizations without being able to just, oh, madam, so happy to see
you. Look. Well, like, I know. You see, that's the thing. I've worked in civil service. It's hard, yo. But this is what sets us back, you know? Pew Research did a publication to show the amount of hours people spend working in civil service. Mm. And the average amount of, like, the amount of time people spend doing work in public service in different countries. I think the U.S. spends, government worker spends an average, I think, 5 hours, 45 minutes a day.
Mm.
Guess how many in Nigeria? 28 minutes. Like, doing the work itself.
I'm not surprised, actually.
Yeah. So I was like, uh-oh. So when you do 9 to 5, 28 minutes, like, you know? So all this madam, all this thing, you never pass our office, never greet us. You know those trivialities?
Yeah.
So when I worked in government, I worked in a law firm and I resumed work at 6 a.m. in the morning. I was in court every day.
Mm.
I was litigating like a bastard. I was back to back. You know, my cases were, I was on it. When I moved to civil service, 8:30, people are still working. 9 o'clock, people are still working. And I went to drop my daughter. I was like, what? You know, that's how uselessness creeps in.
Yeah.
So I feel like for the society, you have to recognize how things work in those spaces. And I think your point is valid. Knowing how to work within the structure is very important.
It saves you a lot of stress. Imagine people that can't pretend. Imagine people who's, it shows on their face. And when it shows on your face, they're going to want to give it back to you.
Oh, yeah. They say, yeah. Oh, you think you can? Show you.
You know?
You're right.
So, man. Yeah, you should. When you have that, man, you...
Yeah, I have to learn.
The good thing for you is that you've had the blessing and the privilege of being in places that, you know, you don't need that too much.
You know? Yeah. Which is why I prescribe, like, I tell people, like, if you're in Nigeria for like a full 10 years and engaging in every social issue, you should be mad by now. Like, you can't be normal right now. Like, you know. So this way you pretend, it becomes your daily norm. But you're right. I need to learn some of that.
I guess that in order for it to not be your daily norm, that's why it's good to have, you know, your people.
Thank you very much.
You have your people, it makes it easier to go out in the world, be whatever you need to be.
That is so important.
And come back to your people.
And you have to have someone or some people that you can be yourself with.
Oh.
Oh my God. It's so therapeutic.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? There's some friends of mine, I'm just like, oh my God. You know, people that you can be yourself and they still respect you. And they still
cherish you. Yeah.
Whoa. I say people like, for me, friendship I lose my friendship based on one thing and one thing only, lack of respect. My friends can lie, steal, okay. But when the person disrespects you, that's it. Like, you can't, I don't know how to explain it. There's just, the friendship is gone. So having that group of people who we can be yourself and they still value you as their person, they still, even if you can be stupid, crazy, drunk, mad, ugly, clean, dirty, whatever.
Yeah.
But then they still value that, ah, this person is still, you know, that's just, you need it.
And that revitalizes you.
Yes.
You
know? I say when you can form for other people in front of your friend and it's okay, then that's like, my friend's working and I they know I'm putting my lawyer. You know, you just need that.
And they get it.
They get it and it's okay, you know? Hey. Oh my, that thing is valuable. We all need that, man. Yeah.
Oh man, thank God for good friends. Man.
Thank God for good friends.
You know?
Yeah. And sometimes you have to work with what you have. Friends take a while. Because I have friends who I know that we value and we love each other, but some of them are very close minded. And I know close mindedness is not something people just take on themselves.
Yeah.
Lack of exposure, lack of knowledge in certain things or certain areas make people the way they are. So people take time to, give people time, sort of try to lead on, but don't impose.
Yeah.
My friend might be doing something very ignorant or very, you know, I don't know, but like with more engagement, people sort of try to get.
That's better. A lot about you, man. I didn't like that you pointed out because, you know, if you're someone's friend, be their friend. You don't get to pick and choose the moments.
No,
you know?
No.
If you're someone's friend, like even if, and if you can be friends with people who are close-minded and people who are, that says a lot.
That is it. My friends are, if you look at my friends and think this is how you figure me out, you'll be wasting your goddamn time. My best friend is uber, super religious. I'm not. In fact, he would hate the fact that I refer him to as religious, but he's written about 40 Christian books. And this is my best friend. And I'm not in any way. Like, I'm not like church going. That's not me, right?
Yeah.
But what connects us is greater than what does not connect us. And we have arguments. Yesterday, we have arguments about abortion. I'm like, guy, I am pro-abortion because of if I was a girl, I would do abortion. Like, they're telling me that somebody, are you kidding? Like, but he's like, no, how dare you? This is the this is the pinnacle. Like, we would argue, but when we're done, we'd eat and move on. Right? But that's it. Of course, I have friends who are just like me and we're very alike and we vibe. We're both leftist, liberal. And then, you know, I have friends who are, you know, the other way around. But like I said, respect is very important. I value my friends just as much as I value myself and they do the same. Friendship is gold. And that's more important than family sometimes because you don't choose. You're just like stuck with these people. And family can be entitled. They just feel like they own your time and they deserve your respect. Like, I see you, I dare you, you know?
Yeah.
But friends are, they don't owe you shit, but they're there.
But they're
That's very important. Yeah. Once I can cry in front of you, and you, I don't care if you're 80, 60, you have something that will make you cry.
Yeah.
And if you can cry with someone who's like, it's okay, you can cry, like, then that's really valid.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, man. Can you imagine those people who spend their time with fake friends? Those people who they know these guys are bad for them, but they can't help it.
It's like sometimes I used to wonder why people do that, but then I realized that that's the only option some people have.
Oh, yeah.
I don't have real friends. I might as well just have fake friends.
Mm.
I can pay for their time. Why not? You know, it could be better, but then you know, this is it. But then it's a working. I have a friend who's like very wealthy, and anytime girls come around and because I hand someone wants my money, and I'm like, dude, shut the F up. No one is all about your money, your goddamn money. You have a shitty attitude, deal with it. Money's not gonna, people will stick around because you're bringing the money, but in the long run, you still have a bloody shitty attitude. Keep your bloody money and be a nice person. Listen,
you said that
to learn. Yeah, we fell out quite a number of times, but I'm like, not everything is about you. He's a very technical person, so he tries to calculate a lot. If he goes somewhere, he's trying to figure out what the girl is doing. I'm just like, dude, if you're trying to look for something bad about somebody, you will find it. If you want to find dangers of eating tomatoes, Google it. You will find someone that said there was one danger, one thing inside. Like, there's something. So take people for who they are and step down from your power trip, you know?
Yeah.
Like, people who are fine, everybody just wants me because I'm fine. Okay. Like, you know, like, move on. Like, figure that people are just people.
Yeah.
And once you vibe with someone, that's enough. For me, when I like a person, I don't need them to like me back.
I'm not like, oh, I like it. Yeah. You know, no. If I want to give someone, I don't need anything from you.
Yeah.
If I love you, like, I really like you. I really like, I don't care. I don't need your feedback.
Mm.
I don't need your reciprocity.
Yeah.
And I've grown mature to that. I'm just communicating this to you because I feel this way and I want to let you know. Period. Yeah. Done. If I like someone and I like their company, I don't need them to come and I do for your wedding, do for my wedding. Let's come. No, I don't need that.
Yeah.
I can do for you and I can keep doing. I don't have to, you know, I don't have to get it back in return.
That's that good mentality right there, man.
Yeah.
Like you're self-reliant. You get it?
Absolutely.
Like you don't need.
Yeah.
Whatever you need, you can get from yourself.
Yes,
you get, and that feeling is so empowering.
It is.
Oh man,
it is so empowering. Oh. You have no idea.
Oh man,
you have no idea.
No. If only they taught this in school somehow.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah, and sometimes we learn it from the streets. Sometimes we learn it from the streets. We don't learn it from school. There's only so even what I learned from school, from my secondary school. I remember when I went to get my WAC results from school, my dad had beaten me at home.
Mm.
And then those are days you have to go to the school to pick up the result.
Because
I had like D's and E's and F's. This was final result from... When I got to the school, they said, wow, one of the best students this year. My dad cried, first time. He was like, I think I ruined your 6 years of your life. How can you be the best student? You have an F in CRK, you have a D in maths, you have a D here. And the school is saying you're the best result. What did the school get? You know, he's like, this is school, I ruined you. And I told him, look, we didn't have teachers. We didn't have anything. This was like way in the north.
Your dad admitted that he ruined you.
Yeah, he said, I thought you, because it was a boarding school. He never, I was like, dude, but you know what? I didn't get academic education, but social education, boy, I got. I got socially educated. Yeah. What? So that when I went to university, I was like, what are we going to do here? Like, I'd been there, done that, got a t-shirt for it. There's nothing about life I did not experience in that 6 years of secondary school. But I was fully baked adult when I finished. I knew everything about everything, except academics.
Yeah. wow.
Yeah, so sometimes let's not undermine that street cred, that street education is very important.
Of course, of course.
Of
course, I'm just saying, imagine if you were more intentional about it.
Yeah, imagine. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, you come into class. In fact, I'll tell you a story. I don't know if you saw my Instagram. I had the privilege of talking to kids at Elamin.
Yes, I saw that. School. I saw that.
And I could see the in their eyes, like when someone, I was telling them that life is hard out there and that your grades might not get you through it.
They were like, huh?
You know? And at first they were like, huh? And I was like, and I told them my own story about when I was in high school and how, you know, I was, if you guys are doing a popularity contest here in school, I was that kid that you guys didn't invite to stuff, you know? And now I'm here, you know, talking to you guys, looking all fresh and clean and smelling like, you know, with the sexy, but yeah.
Nice. You know?
Yeah, so, and they were, they took to it, like they understood that, that life is more than this, and I just, anyway, I can't go into details of that because I can't remember right now, but you know, those things that they were talking about right now, I was just telling to them, having a conversation with them, they were asking questions, and I was like, yeah, guys, like, enjoy here while it lasts, but get strong here, man, get strong because you'll be tested.
Yeah.
You'd be tested, and
you see, imagine we got something like that.
Like that.
We didn't get any of that. No one told us any of that.
We did.
No one told us. So in my secondary school, they used to bring out the best three and the last three from every, we call it first monthly order, like every set of tests we do. They used to call me as one of the best three then, and I was like, oh my God, I'm smart. But then they used to call the worst three as well. And there's a particular guy, they always called him one of the worst three. It's bad as that my school was not very academically focused. For it to not be the worst three, it's like, how can you be like such a school, public school? What?
Yeah.
But he used to always come out worse. And that's how we knew each other and, you know, we laugh and, you know. But my first, when I went to, I was practicing law. I didn't have a car then. I heard somebody call my name. This was like several years after secondary school, of course. And, you know, when someone calls your name from secondary school, they call your full name. So I was like, who is this person? So I turned, it was that guy who always came last. He was like, Jesus, look at you. When I was screaming his name. Oh my God, you know. Where have you been? He's like, I'm in Abuja. I was like, I'm in Abuja too. He goes, across the road is my car shop. I was like, you car shop? And I was like, are you kidding? You know, we started talking back about secondary school.
Yeah.
And he was like, where are you coming from? I said, from court. He goes, where's your car or cars? I said, I don't have one. He said, but you used to come first. Anyways, the conversation, we laughed and we laughed and we talked for like 3 hours.
Yeah.
The evening ended with me driving one of his cars home. He's like, there's no way it would be a shame if I tell my people that, you know, no. So on the WhatsApp group we joined, like, he gave me one of his cars. He goes, when you have money, pay. You can pay instrumentally. I was like, no. I mean, it was a cheap ass car, but that was my first car.
Yeah.
Wow. So he said, this is my shop. I have over, like 50 cars. Of course, he's successful, married, rich, spoke, he speaks well, everything.
Yeah.
Like he's an adult.
Mm.
His grades didn't define him. But imagine if we didn't connect in high school. Imagine if I looked over his head, I didn't vibe with him because he wasn't smart enough.
Yeah.
Now I look back and I thank God we always laughed at those. Like we were not friends, but we were a guy. I didn't make it, you know?
Yeah.
And I was like, I did a post about it. This is the guy who was getting last in class, who helped me, you know.
Mm.
Not to think that my grades were great as well, but like this is life, you know. So school helps networking as well. You know, how do you treat people when because some people don't forget how they were treated when they are young.
They don't.
What impression are you leaving with your colleagues from school matters.
Yeah.
So it's not just about competition and your kid is doing good. It's about who they are as a person.
Mm.
What values do they imbibe? How do they treat other people?
Yeah.
You know, moving forward, what does that mean, you know, in the future? So I was really happy to vibe with him. And then I knew that grades and shit, they are good. Grades are good. Let's not undermine it. Because, I mean, if I didn't make good grades in school, I wouldn't have gone to, like, a school as prestigious as the University of Oxford.
Because
those schools are very grade-centric.
Yeah.
I remember they calling me on the phone when I submitted my application. They are saying, well, see, you have really good grades, but some grades, just you have F. Like, we could understand if you had, like, a B or C. The grades I was good at, I got A's in like some really, really good, some law courses I got F. So they couldn't understand, like, how will you just get F? Like, your transcript is A-A-A-F-F, A-A-A-A-F-F-F. Yeah. Like, what's your, like, are you normal, you know? Yeah, then I have to go into the conversation of some lecture. Like, you know, good grades are great, but that's not everything.
Yeah, in fact, I'll just tell the kids that at 11th school, because one of the kids actually stood up and asked me that, is it really worth it going to school? Like, I want to go into business. He's known in the class as one of the good business people.
Yeah.
So he said to me, you know, do I have to? And I said to him, you know what? I feel you right now. But first of all, new knowledge is a waste. That's the first thing you have to know. Like, everything you know now will serve you well. Even I knew that I never solved for algebra once in my life. I never solved for X. You know? I never solved for X. But, you know, and then I said to him that, if you have good grades, you have a leg up.
Yeah.
If you don't have good grades, it's not the end.
You're right.
That's what I said to him, and he was like, he calmed down. You know, and I think they all got the message.
They all got the message. That's a good one.
Yeah.
That's a really good one.
Yeah.
That's a really, really good one. When people say, oh, Mark Zuckerberg dropped out, I was like, he dropped out from where?
From where?
Like, look at this, where he dropped out from.
Yeah.
So there's... For some people, grades give them confidence. You know, for some people, it just doesn't matter. So it's good to give people the alternatives, like give them all the options. Yeah, grades are great, but besides grades, what else? You know, so that's a good one. I think we need more. We need more of that. But even a business person has to speak well. Just for primary and secondary school, they're teaching you the basics: how to communicate, how to solve problems, just little problems. The difference is university level, you know. Then that one you can say, I don't need or I need or whatever. Beyonce didn't go to university.
Jay-Z
didn't go to university.
Yeah.
But if they did, it's not going to change anything. They still need Beyonce and Jay-Z anyways. Yeah. But it's not the university that made them who they are.
Yeah. What's your favorite quote?
My favorite quote is... Oh my God. It's changed several times.
Yeah, no, readers like us, we always... meet something new every time I read.
Yeah. My favorite quote right now. I don't know. I think it's not even a quote. It's just... it's not a quote, it's an ideology, as I put it. I just believe that right now, I'm here for right now, and now is for right now.
Mm.
and this is something I was talking about yesterday, like I'm here now mm. and now is what matters. So it's not a quote, but just my self-awareness of being here now is the most valuable thing for me now. I'm not planning for something mm. and it's great to plan, but this is now. It's now is most important for me right now. Yeah. How do I feel now? What do I want now? I'm yeah. like, my now is most critical for me, and I maximize that all the time.
I'm glad you mentioned that, because I have this tattoo right here.
Yeah, well, that's
yeah.
nice.
Yeah. And it's the greater than less than sign.
Oh,
facing each other.
Yeah.
And what that means is being present.
Ah.
What has come before and what's to come doesn't matter. All that matters is
so that does in the middle. That's
right now.
That's phenomenal.
Yeah.
That is phenomenal.
That's my thing.
I am. Yeah. I'm so for the now. Yeah. I'm so for the now. Mm. Yeah.
My favorite quote is to improve is to change, to perfect is to change often.
Mm. To improve is to change.
Winston Churchill.
To perfect is to change often.
Yeah.
Wow.
So when you think of
that's profound.
Your life and how you've grown, you're just getting yeah. more perfect.
Yeah.
And perfect.
Yeah.
And perfect.
Yeah. Ah, that's true.
Yeah. Which leads me to my final question. What do you see as the best version of yourself? What do you envision as your God version? Like when you can look in the mirror and be like, you know, I like the man I am. I like what I've become. I know there's no final version, but what can you envision as like peak Jake?
Wow. You know, it's the best version of myself. Because I feel like I experience this a lot.
Yeah.
There are days when I don't feel like I'm myself. I don't feel like 100.
Yeah.
But there are days when I fucking feel like 100. Sorry, mm-hmm. I'm swearing.
Go ahead.
Like, the days when I just, it's nothing really. Mm. I'm up mm. from my bed. I'm healthy. I've eaten. Mm. I'm just looking at the mirror. I'm just like dancing to some stupid music. Mm. I feel like I'm on top of the world. Yeah. I don't need anything. I'm just okay the way that I am. Mm. So the best version of myself is my true self that I have fully accepted.
Mm.
That is the best version of myself. I'm fully aware of who I am and I fully accept it.
That is it.
That is my best version. It's, I can't, I like, I don't even, you know, there's, when you're complete, they can't add on top. Like,
yeah.
Like, I'm just full. I'm, you know,
that's
it. I wish people can experience it. Because I just got to the point where I'm okay.
Just got that fulfilling part.
I'm okay. You know, I look into the mirror and like, it's me though. Like, this is me though. Like, I'm not judging, trying to, this is me, period. Yeah.
You know, it's very tough to visualize that, because there's like, 8 billion people on Earth.
Yeah.
And in fact, an interesting stat, there's more people alive now than have ever died in history. Did you know that?
I didn't even know that.
There's more people alive today
than there are people
that have ever died in all of history.
This is crazy, y'all.
Yeah. And then when you think of your place in all of that, being that one just unique individual, man, it's both freeing and scary at the same time. That's why it's so weird being a person, you know? It's like,
yeah.
How do you balance that responsibility and still that nothingness of your existence?
You're so right. It is so bloody humbling. Like, you know, you feel so self-important. Like, you know, me, I have people who say things like, you know, if I'm in a car crash, if I'm in an airplane, that airplane cannot crash, Joe. Am I not inside? I think that way sometimes. I'm in a car, like, it can't happen. I'm the one here now.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, but I'm like, everyone thought they're the ones. Like, people who have, what makes you think you're so special that other people can, only you cannot? Like, you're just being limited in your thinking, but you're being unaware of the things and people around you. Everyone is special. Mm. It's just the same way you are.
Mm-hmm.
So it's one way to recognize your, you know, your godship as an individual, but your God over yourself, your authority over yourself,
yeah.
Not over everyone else.
Yeah.
And until and when you gain that authority and you're fully aware about yourself and you take full control of that, then that's the only, there's nothing else left for you, because you are your jurisdiction.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's it. So leave other issues, leave other people, focus on yourself and do yourself the best justice you can. So I'm always my best self when I'm just in my own skin.
Your element.
I'm my element. I'm just, and my element's not for anybody, just for me though. Yeah. I'm just me loving me for no reason, right? And the only thing I can accrue to that is just accepting myself and just, you know, enveloping myself in that acceptance.
Mm-hmm. Man, see, we've broken it down to the simplest thing. wow, this is a 2-hour conversation.
Yeah, this is a long one.
This is the longest I've ever done. Yeah, and I think I'm really worried about the length of these things, but I feel like what we've done here today is what I think you will listen to it and then repeat it.
Yeah, I would even listen to it, because some of the things you've said here are very profound, and I feel like you've challenged me, and not many people are able to do that. Not like I'm difficult to challenge, but like, I don't know, I'm in a different mind space.
Yeah.
So you have really given me, like, you've shaking me up in ways that I didn't think I could be shaken up. And you've said some things that I will definitely ruminate over and over again.
I'm glad.
So thanks for that.
No, the feeling is mutual. The feeling is mutual. Oh man, I mean, and this is what we're here. This is what you know, we try to do on this podcast. There's so many, when people sit down like this and just talk.
Yeah.
You know, just go from, just let, you know, the energy bounce all over and see where it goes. This is what happens when we just talk and we arrive at some basic truth about something.
And that wraps up this episode. Thank you for listening. If you love this content, do subscribe and do share with your friends and colleagues. You can follow the podcast on Instagram at younggodpod. You can also follow me, the host, Rodney, on Instagram and Twitter at Rodney Avo. Rodney Avo, one word. Do leave some feedback, do review the podcast, and I'll be happy to hear from any of you. Rodney, out.